We are in a sermon series entitled Know Him, Show Him. The first four Sabbaths of December, Pastor Michael focused on knowing Christ, knowing God. And these last four Sabbaths, this Sabbath and next Sabbath, Pastor Ezekias will preach, and then the following Sabbath, Pastor Michael will preach, and the following Sabbath on January 21, Evangelist Taj Pakleb will be here. You will not want to miss that Sabbath. We, starting today, are going to embark on this journey of learning what it means to show Him. We've known Christ, we've learned to know God. Now we want to learn, how can we show God? In fact, on January 14, we are going to begin our 40 days of show. Now last year, or this past year, the beginning of this year, we had 40 days of prayer where every day we had an accountability partner and we were praying for each other for 40 days. This year on January 14, and we're going to culminate in the end of February with our wildfire student outreach, we are going to have 40 days of practically showing care and reaching out to people. What is that going to look like? You're going to find out. Mark it on your calendar, January 14. My message today is one that is close to my heart. And by God's grace, I hope through God's word to answer one question. And the one question is this. How do we reach the masses of people in our community, in our state, in our country, and in this world for Jesus? The question is a simple one. How do we reach the multitudes of people in this world for Jesus Christ? Let's pray. Oh God, we come to you, and I'm reminded of what Jesus said in John 15, verse 5. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. God, I cannot do anything. And so, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would glue me, this weak preacher, to Christ so that I can bear fruit and so that your people here can also connect to Christ and bear fruit for your glory. Teach us, answer this question, how do we reach the world for you? In Jesus' name I pray, amen. I invite you to turn with me to the fourth book of the New Testament, the fourth gospel, that is the gospel of John. John chapter 1, right in the beginning, John chapter 1, beginning with verse 35. I love this book. In fact, when I speak to Christians who are just learning how to walk with Christ, I encourage them to study the book of John, because this book is a love letter to us about what Christ has done for us. John chapter 1, beginning with verse 35. I will begin. Verse 35. Again, the next day, John, this is speaking about John the Baptist, stood with two of his disciples. Verse 36. And looking at Jesus as he walked, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." Verse 37, the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. Verse 38, then Jesus turned and seeing them following, said to them, "What do you seek?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which is to say, when translated, "teacher," "where are you staying?" Verse 39, he said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying and remained with him that day. Now it was about the 10th hour. This is John the Baptist, and you can imagine he has two disciples following him. And then he says, "Behold the Lamb of God." Those two disciples, their interest is piqued. They look, and they say, is this the one? Is this the promised one? So they follow Christ. One of the disciples, his name is Andrew, and we pick up the story in verse 40. The Bible says, one of the two who heard John speak and followed him, speaking about Christ, was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Now, we don't know much about this disciple Andrew, but with the little that we do know, we know that the name Andrew means manly. Do we have any Andrews here? Okay, maybe not. But if you know someone who's Andrew, that person, his name means manly. And this was a fitting description for the disciple, for the apostle Andrew, because he was a manly fisherman by trade. Because, you know, all fishermen are manly, right? All any man who goes fishing is manly. According to tradition, it is believed that Andrew was killed on an X-shaped cross. So we know that this encounter with Christ, this encounter with Jesus, made a significant impact in his life. Notice what Andrew does after he follows Jesus, verse 41. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated the Christ. Now let's pick apart that first phrase, "He first found his own brother." First, let's focus on that word "found." This word "found," this finding, was not accidental. It was purposeful, a purposeful finding. When you lose your keys, you don't accidentally say, okay, I'm going to accidentally bump into my keys so I can go to work. You purposefully try to find your keys. So there was purpose here in this finding. You see, when you meet Jesus Christ, when you and I meet Jesus Christ, we will purposely find someone to tell. Ellen White said in Steps to Christ, page 78, please listen. "No sooner does one come to Christ than there is born in his heart a desire to make known to others what a precious friend he has found in Jesus. The saving and sanctifying truth cannot be shut up in his heart." If you agree, please say amen. "No sooner does one come to Christ than there is born in his heart a desire to make known to others what a precious friend he has found in Jesus." And when you meet Jesus Christ, you can't wait to tell someone, and you will purposely try to find someone to tell someone about Christ. So he first found his own brother. But let's focus on that second word. He first found his own brother. Finding his brother was the first thing that Andrew did. Notice that Andrew did not grab a bite to eat first. He didn't go to Subway first. He didn't go fishing for a few days first after he met Christ. Andrew did not wait until the following week first to tell Simon Peter about Jesus. The Bible says that Andrew found his brother first. So when you meet Christ, when we meet Jesus, not only will we be purposeful of finding someone to tell, we are going to tell people immediately, because you can't keep good news to yourself. You know, when I was a pastor in Wisconsin, I remember spending time with a group of people. One girl caught my attention. Her name was Catherine. And I was falling in like with her. We weren't falling in love yet. We were falling in like. So we were falling in like, and I decided one day, all right, I'm going to profess my like, that I like her. And so it was after a trip. She was there. Her brother was in the apartment. And I was hoping he wasn't awake, because I didn't want him to hear my profession of like to Catherine. So I mustered up enough courage. I rang that doorbell. I walked through that red hallway there at Monticello Apartments. I think it was on a Sheboygan Avenue there in Madison, Wisconsin. I'll never forget that. I knocked on that door, and I braced myself. All right, here we go. I saw Catherine, and lo and behold, her brother was asleep. Yes, Edwin is asleep. So now I have this chance. And I remember looking at her and telling her, "I just want to say something. I like you." Now, I want to share with you what the rest of the conversation was like. But I want to tell you that it was an exciting conversation. I left the apartment, and I remember going into my car, closing the door, and you guess what I did? I immediately called one of my good friends, and I said, "Guess what? I just told Catherine that I like her." I didn't wait till night. I didn't wait till the next week. When you encounter someone special in your life, you will immediately tell someone. Can I hear an amen? So he first found his own brother. Who does Andrew tell after he meets Jesus? The Bible doesn't say that he tells all of his friends. He doesn't go to his favorite hangout spot and doesn't tell his friends. The Bible doesn't say that he first tells all of his relatives. The Bible doesn't say that he tells his church family. The Bible says that Andrew tells his brother. How many people did Andrew tell about Jesus? Andrew told one person. Here's the question that we are trying to answer by God's grace. How do we reach the world? Well, let's keep going. Second story, let's pick it up in verse 43. Same chapter, John chapter 1, verse 43. The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip, and he said to him, "Follow me." Verse 44, now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip meets and he sees Jesus Christ. What does Philip do? Let's pick it up in verse 45. Philip found who? Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." The first thing Philip does after he meets Jesus is he finds his one friend, Nathanael, to tell him about Jesus Christ. You know, sometimes when you share Christ, you share about your faith with someone, you know, some people are happy and they're thrilled for you. They're thrilled to learn about this God named Jesus Christ. But you know, some people, and let's be honest, you've been in a situation maybe where you've shared your faith and someone was a skeptic and said, "I don't know about that whole faith thing." Some people are just naturally skeptical and they don't take you at face value. Notice how this skeptic Nathanael reacts to Philip in the next verse, verse 46. And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Come on, Philip, seriously. You sound the Messiah? And he's from Nazareth. Nazareth was not mentioned in the Old Testament prophets. It was an insignificant town, hardly a place where one would look to find a redeemer of Israel. Nazareth was not an important town and had a bad reputation for wickedness in all of Galilee. So Nathanael says, "Come on, Philip, seriously. Can anything good come out of Nazareth, that insignificant city?" Notice what Philip says in the rest of that verse in verse 46. The Bible says, Philip said to him three words, "Come and see." Nathanael, I know that you're a little skeptical because Jesus is from Nazareth, but I have three words for you. Come and see. And I want to tell you something this morning in case you're scared of sharing your faith, and in case you're scared of someone saying, "Oh, I don't know about that God stuff." I want to tell you that Jesus does not need to be defended. Jesus can defend himself. Jesus can defend himself. And look what happens when this skeptic Nathanael goes right to Jesus Christ. Pick it up in verse 47. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Verse 48, Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Verse 49, Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. Now I know you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus turned this skeptic into a believer. When you share your faith with someone, when you share Christ with someone, and they're skeptical, you don't have to say much. You don't have to try to defend God. All you have to say is, "Hey, come and see Jesus for yourself." Come and see Jesus for yourself. Jesus can change the heart of any skeptic. Maybe you've came in here as a skeptic and you're a nun. You're not religiously affiliated with any church and you're thinking, I'm skeptical. I want to tell you that there's something special about this man, this God named Jesus Christ, and he can change the heart of any skeptic. I know firsthand, his name was Xiang. It took me a while to learn how to say his name. I was a pastor in Madison, Wisconsin. And I met this group of young adults from the University of Wisconsin there in Madison in 2007. I met this Korean man who became my roommate later on. His name was Sabbath. And his sister's name was Ellen. Go figure. So here's Sabbath, and I met his friend. His name was Xiang. He said, "Nestor, just call me Sean, but I wanted to say it correctly. It's spelled X-I-A-N-G. He's from China. I had a hard time, but I got it. So it's Xiang. Sabbath would tell me, and I think Sean even mentioned to me, that early, the year before I came, they were roommates, and they would go at it. I mean, they would pull out their intellectual boxing gloves and just fight about religion. How can you believe in God? Well, how can you not believe in God? And they would just go back and forth, just intellectually boxing each other. And finally, one day, he started to become curious about this whole Christianity and this faith thing. So he actually bought himself a Bible because he wanted to see if it was intellectually credible. One of my friends, I made a new friend, his name was Jared. Jared said, hey, would you like to, I know you're showing interest in the Bible, would you like to come and see? Would you like to study the Bible? Which is literally, he was literally saying, hey, why don't you come and see for yourself? And so I remember going to one of those Bible studies, and I remember Jared popping in a DVD, and they would watch a DVD, and they would discuss, and they studied the Bible week after week, month after month. And after several months, I asked my friend Jared, I said, Jared, has Sheng ever thought about getting baptized? He said, that's a great question. Let me ask. So Jared went to Sheng and said, Sheng, have you ever thought about getting baptized before? He said, actually, Jared, I have thought about getting baptized. And so I continued studying with Sheng, and in 2008, in the summer of 2008, at Camp Wakanda, there in the lake, I had the privilege of baptizing this former atheist into Christ's church, into Jesus Christ and his church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Can you say amen? Jesus took an atheist who did not believe in God, and he turned him into a believer. And you know today, Sheng is still in church. He's still following Christ. In fact, he is the only Christian in his immediate family. Jesus can change a skeptic into a believer. How many people did Philip reach after he met Jesus Christ? How many? He reached one. And who knows how many people Nathaniel reached in his lifetime? He reached hundreds, if not thousands. Let's go back to that first character there that we learned in the first passage that we studied. How many people did Andrew reach after he found Jesus Christ? Andrew reached one. He reached his brother Simon Peter, and Peter, we know, reached thousands for Jesus Christ in his lifetime. We know from Acts chapter 2 that he preached his first evangelistic series, and 3,000 people believed in Christ and were baptized. So the question is, how do we reach the thousands and millions of lost people in this world? Here's the answer. We reach the world by reaching one. We reach this county by reaching only one. We reach this state by reaching only one. Don't be shy. How many of you make New Year's resolutions? Can you raise your hand? Okay, that's well below the average here. According to statisticbrain.com, I don't know where they're getting these stats, most likely not in this community. They say 45% of Americans usually make New Year's resolutions. Okay, 45%. So I'd like to say half, but obviously we didn't have half, so we'll take them at face value here. Okay, 45%. You know what they say? Out of the 45%, only 8% of these people are successful in achieving their resolutions. Wow, only 8%. That's kind of sad. Now, there are several reasons, but one reason why we fail to achieve our goals is because we just have too many goals. In this article in dailymail.com, the title of that article, How to Achieve Your New Year's Resolutions, Expert Says Keep Them Realistic and Expect Small Changes. Notice Professor Peter Herman. He is a psychology lecturer at the University of Toronto. He says that the reason resolutions fail is because they are too ambitious. Ooh, let me read that to you again. He says that the reason resolutions fail is because they are too ambitious. He continues, they are unrealistic in some or all of the following respects. People think that they can change more quickly than is the case. They think they can change more than is the case. Or they think they can change more easily than is the case. And so he offers a solution. Professor Herman says this. He says that the best way to stick to your resolution is to make it more realistic. And he says, quote, often this means scaling back your resolution to something that is actually measurable. Wow. He says, you want to keep your resolutions? Scale it back to something that is actually manageable. Now you can think of, let's just use a random name, Thaddeus, because we don't have any Thaddeuses here, right? Okay, let's say average person, Thaddeus, ambitious. All right, December 31, I'm going to make my New Year's resolutions. Here we go. One, I'm going to get out of debt. Number two, I'm going to lose weight. Number three, I'm going to get into a regular exercise routine. I'm going to exercise 6 days a week, at least 30 minutes every single time I exercise. I'm going to travel to Spain and Thailand. I'm going to get more organized. Then I'm going to spend less and save more. I'm going to volunteer at church. I'm also going to run a full marathon. I'm going to get 2 dogs, and I'm going to start a new business. Guess what? He is setting himself up for failure. Scale it back. But let's talk about us here at this church. I know what you've been thinking, and I'm guilty of this too. Maybe you've said this, all right, we are going to reach the entire Laramie County for Jesus Christ. Let's do it in 2017. We're going to baptize 50 people at every single evangelistic series because it can happen. We're going to knock on 5,000 doors. We're going to study the Bible with 200 pre-Christian people. Could it be that we won't actually reach these goals because we have too many and these goals are too big? Now, I'm not saying that we should not have grandiose goals. No, we should have big goals. We should have big vision. We should have a heart that says, I'm going to do my very best in my occupation. I'm going to excel in school because if I do my very best, people, I will have more influence and I can impact people in the community. So we should have big goals. We should have a heart that says, Lord, help me to reach the United States for you. But too often, we aim to reach the moon when we don't even have a rocket yet. We try to ride a bike when we haven't even learned on training wheels. We try to take calculus when we don't understand algebra. We aim to pray for 1 hour every single day. All right, I'm super ambitious, here we go, when we're not even praying for at least 10 minutes every single day. We say, all right, this time I'm gonna quit smoking for 10 months. When you haven't been successful for at least 10 days. You try to reach Larimer County for Christ when you haven't even reached your children. You want to lead 100 people to Christ in 2017? All right, 100 people for Christ in 2017 when you haven't even led one person to Christ in 2016. The problem is not a big vision. It's not having a big vision. The problem is not taking small, realistic steps. We reach big goals by focusing on a few. So my sister-in-law, this past week we were in Costco, and I forgot that they actually sell books at Costco at Amazon prices. So she picked up this super thick book called Tools of Titans, written by Tim Ferriss. And so I was looking through the book at their home, and I caught this line by Seth Godin. So Tim Ferriss, he interviews people in his book, and he interviews this man by the name of Seth Godin. He's the author of 18 best-selling books that have been translated into more than 35 languages. So Tim Ferriss asks Seth, how do you create something great? And do you know what Seth Godin says? This is gold right here. Should I share it with you or should I just keep? Okay, I'll share it with you. I'll be nice. He says this. My suggestion is, whenever possible, ask yourself, what's the smallest possible footprint I can get away with? What is the smallest possible project that is worth my time? What is the smallest group of people who I could make a difference for or to? Because smallest is achievable. Smallest feels risky, because if you pick smallest and you will fail, now you've really screwed up. We want to pick big. Infinity is our friend. Infinity is safe. Infinity gives us a place to hide. So I want to encourage people instead to look for the small, to be on one medium in one place where people can find you. And he's speaking about building a tribe, a platform, a digital a platform, a network of people. He says to have one sort of interaction with one tribe, with one group, where you don't have a lot of lifeboats. Did you catch what he said? The smallest is achievable. The smallest is achievable. We accomplish great goals by going small. Perhaps we can learn a lesson from Jesus Christ himself, our Savior, in Matthew chapter 25. You know the story, verse 14. Jesus said here, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey." Verse 16, "Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5. Good on you." Verse 17, "And likewise he who had received 2 gained 2 more also." Verse 18, "But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money." Verse 19, "After a long time the Lord of these servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came. He brought 5 other talents, saying, 'Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents beside them.'" Here's a key verse. Look at verse 21. "His Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You are faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord.' He also who had received 2 talents came and said, 'Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them.'" Look at verse 23. His Lord said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." Could it be that we reach big goals by focusing on a few? I believe that. I remember here, we held our evangelistic series this past October, No More Fear. You know, you hold an evangelistic series, you expect to baptize 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 people every time you hold a series. And I'm not opposed to reaching 30, 40, 50 people for Christ. But here's my question to a church that has not been in, that is just starting a culture of reaching people. How can we expect to reach 100 people if we're not faithful in reaching just a few? Jesus Christ, he said through this parable, "You are faithful in the few, so now I can bless you to be ruler over many." Faithful in the few. And Jesus Christ, he believed and practiced this truth. When he started his public ministry, Jesus did not start preaching an evangelistic series. He didn't start preaching in church. You know what Christ did? Instead of reaching the masses, focusing on reaching the masses, Christ reached the world by selecting a few disciples. Yes, he had 70, but he had a closer 12. And yes, he had 12 disciples, but he focused on a few. I like what Robert Coleman says in his book, The Master Plan of Evangelism. If you haven't read it, pick it up. It's worth it. He says this, page 21. "It all started by Jesus calling a few men to follow him." And then he continues in verse 24, "One cannot transform a world except as individuals in the world are transformed. And individuals cannot be changed except as they are molded in the hands of the Master. The necessity is apparent not only to select a few helpers, but also to keep the group small enough to be able to work effectively with them." Jesus reached the masses by concentrating on a few. And we know that from Philip. Perhaps we can learn a lesson from Philip. When Philip met Jesus Christ, he did not focus on reaching the masses. He reached out to only one person. Verse 45 of John chapter 1, we read it already. Philip found Nathanael, one person. And who knows how many people Nathanael reached for Christ. Perhaps we can learn a lesson from Andrew. When Andrew met Jesus, he didn't focus on reaching the masses. He reached out to only one person because the Bible says in verse 41 of the same chapter, he first found his own brother, one person. And what did Simon Peter do for Christ? He reached thousands in this world for Jesus. Here's the answer to the question. How can we reach the world for Christ? We reach the world by reaching one. We reach the world by reaching one. So Nestor, that sounds fine and dandy. How do we actually do that? I'm going to give you a few tips. First, one, you have to have a desire and a commitment. All right, this year, 2017, I'm going to make an impact in at least just one person's life. You can say, you can pick 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's fine. But is there someone in your sphere of influence, a family member, a coworker, a friend, where you can say, I'm just going to focus on helping and impacting one person for Christ? You've got to make that commitment. So you might ask, so how do I choose who to reach for Jesus in 2017? That's a great question. Maybe a coworker, maybe it's a neighbor, maybe a stranger, an acquaintance you make. Or maybe like Philip, you can go to a friend, he reached Nathaniel. You can go to an old friend who has left the church. Or maybe you can be like Andrew and go right to your family, start at home, reach out to a brother, a sister, a mom, dad, a son and daughter. Ultimately, just say, God, I want to make this commitment, and pray to him and say, Lord, would you impress me with just one person that I can impact for you in 2017? So after you make that commitment, after you choose, what can I do? Here are some ideas. Go out to eat with that one person just once a month. It's not hard. Just once a month to build a friendship. Just once a month. Get a bite to eat together. Here's another idea. Pray for each other once a month over the phone. I do this with another individual, a friend of mine. Here's another idea. Invite your friends to your home for a cookout and social just once this year. One friend, only once. It's simple. Make one visit at the hospital, just one visit when someone is sick. I want to tell you something. I went visiting this past week on Wednesday night. Went to visit Ron Kuhn's daughter. She was sick. But when I was in that home, and you know, Ron and Steve, these guys are jokesters. They just have this, you have families that love each other by telling jokes and but you know that they care. And I was over there, and I remember opening up the Word of God and reading a word, Ron, I want to give you a text, Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I'm with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, yes. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. After I read that text, I could see her there lying on the bed with tears in her eyes, because I know that God's word spoke peace and hope to her. That one visit, I believe, made a difference. Or could it be making one visit to someone's home who hasn't been to church in a while? You know, unfortunately, we've had two losses in our community of faith here in this church family in the last few days, both Gene Olson and Glenn Douthat. And if we have any relatives or friends here, my condolences from our pastoral staff. But you know the story of Glenn Douthat, lovely, wonderful man. He had not been coming to church for a long time. But I remember one of our elders, Ben Trujillo, this is about a year and a half ago in the fall of 2015, he made a visit to his house. That one visit told Glenn, you know what? Ben and the church cares. And when he was able to come back to church. And I remember he would sit there with his wife right there, third row, and he would sit there when he was physically able. One visit made an eternal difference in this man's life. One visit. Another idea is make one invitation, just one invitation to church event. I'm not saying 52, I'm saying just one. One invitation can make a difference. What would happen if every one of us here today decided, God, I'm going to reach one person for you in 2017. I wrote it in your welcome, in your bulletin. Here's what I wrote. Let's say you make a New Year's resolution to lead just one person to Jesus in 2017. And then both you and your new disciple friend lead two more to Jesus in 2018. That's one each. And then you four now win four more for Jesus the next year. You eight win eight. You 16 win 16. You 32 win 32. You 64 win 64. In 70 years, by 2023, unless Jesus Christ comes first, which I hope he does, but if by 2023, you would have 128 disciples of Jesus, including yourself. And it only starts with reaching one person. Just one. We can reach the world by reaching one person at a time. We reach the world by just reaching one. Xander was a student here, Campion Academy, just graduated this past year. In our 40 days of prayer earlier this year, I said, I'm going to pray. I'm going to have an accountability partner, and I'm going to pray weekly with someone. And I want a student. For some reason, God impressed me, pray with Xander for those 40 days every week. And so that's what we did. One person, just once a week. We prayed together just once a week during that 40 days of prayer. I mentored him to preach. He was selected as one of the seven speakers for our wildfire event. I mentored him to preach just one sermon. He had this topic on what happens when you die. So I mentored him for just one sermon. One guy, once a week we prayed, one sermon for this wildfire student outreach last May. He preached with only one goal, to glorify Jesus Christ. And you know what happened that Monday evening, May 9? You know what happened? I'll never forget that. And some of you who were there will never forget. There was something solemn that happened in that tent that evening. When Solomon preached, Xander preached his heart out, and he made an appeal. He has never made an appeal in his life at that point. And said, if there's someone who wants to follow Christ, be baptized or be rebaptized and come to Christ, come forward. No one came forward. I didn't train him to, I didn't teach him what to say after no one comes forward. So he just put his head down. He started praying. He made the appeal again. If you want to make a decision to follow Christ, come forward. One student stood up, came forward. A second student came up, came forward. Third student, four, five, six, seven people came forward that evening. And I've never seen this before in my life. I've never seen the preacher weep more than those who come forward. And Xander wept, and he said, God, you used me. He started crying out loud. God, I can't, you used me. I didn't know that you could use someone like me. God used one person with six other preachers to impact 14 people who were baptized in May. This past August, under the leadership of Pastor Phil Jones, they held another wildfire event. Those students impacted 14 lives. They had 14 baptisms. And the last sermon that Xander preached, he told me there at his home church there in Colorado during Thanksgiving weekend, he was struggling. Should I make an appeal? Should I not? Should I make an appeal? Should I not? But he decided to make an appeal. And later on, when I turned my phone back on and I looked at my phone, he showed me a picture. He said, guess what? I decided to make an appeal for baptism. And just one person stood up. And that was George. Some of you know George. He was a student here at Campion Academy, Indonesian student. And that afternoon, he was rebaptized. And Xander took a picture of it and said, George came forward and now he's getting rebaptized. Hallelujah. Listen, I believe that Xander is going to reach many people. Why is that? Because I worked alongside Jesus Christ in reaching and discipling just one person. Yeah, there were other people that I influenced. But just one person. And I believe that he, plus all of our other wildfire speakers, even the ones that are coming up here in February, are going to make an impact for Christ. How do we reach the world? We reach the world by focusing on one. But why should we reach out to people? You don't reach out to someone because your pastor tells you to or because you have to. You don't reach out to people because you feel that it's an obligation. You reach out to people because Jesus saved you and he wants to save people through you. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15, for the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, speaking about Christ, if one died for all, then all died, and he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. The reason you witness and you share Christ with people is because Jesus has saved you. It is the love of Christ that moves me to reach out to someone else. Jesus Christ saved me. And the primary reason I reach out to people, and I have committed the rest of my life to pointing people to the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The primary reason is because Jesus reached out to me. As a 19-year-old teenager in the city of Chicago, I had no purpose in my life. I grew up in the church, but I only went out of tradition and because my friends were there. But two friends decided to focus on one person one spring afternoon, and his name was Nestor. Peter and Wesley focused on one person. They said, Nestor, you got to come and hear this preacher. And when I heard that preacher in August of 2002, that's where I met my best friend, Jesus Christ. And I remember hearing that Jesus loves me. I remember hearing that Jesus has given all to reach me. And something in my heart said, I want to have Jesus in my heart. And I got out of my seat, never did this before in my life during the appeal, and I surrendered my life to Christ, and the rest is history. It hasn't been smooth sailing. There have been struggles and bumps along the way, but I want to tell you that there's no better friend like Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to me, and the reason I reach out to people is because Jesus reached out to me. Don't focus on the numbers. And never say to yourself, just come on, one. I mean, that's one. One soul is of infinite value to our God in heaven. Just one soul. Two more quotes and then I'm done. Ellen White says, manuscript 16, 1886, paragraph 7, she says this, one soul is worth more than all the gold and silver that could be heaped up on this earth. Grab all the silver, grab all the gold, heap it up all in one place. One person sitting in the sanctuary, let's say it was just you and the sanctuary cleared out and it's just you and God. You are more valuable than all of the earth and gold and worldly wealth accumulated in one place. And she also says in Welfare Ministry, page 249, Christ would have died for one soul in order that one might live through the eternal ages. One soul. Clear out this church, it's just you and God in this sanctuary. Jesus would have come and died only for you. For one soul. So don't tell me that just focusing on a few is really going to make a difference. It does. Because one soul, because you are of infinite value in God's eyes. And so my appeal is this. Maybe you have been touched by God's word and you're saying, all right, I'm going to keep it simple and just focus on one. Maybe it's a son or daughter. You're not connected to your children, your child. Maybe you know that life has been so busy and you just haven't had time to really connect with your spouse. Maybe there's a member who's come to this church but hasn't been here for a long time. Maybe there's a friend that you need to reach out to. I don't know who that is. But maybe in your heart, you're saying, Lord, I want to be part of this mission of reaching the world by only reaching one in 2017. Maybe God is speaking to your heart. And you're saying, God, all right. I have some New Year's resolutions I want to make, but I'm just going to pick one for now. Use me, Lord, to reach and impact just one person for Jesus in 2017. If you'd like to make that commitment, just one, would you raise your hand with me? Just one person. Hallelujah. Just one person. And I do want to say this. Maybe you want to reach out to people. Maybe you just want to reach out to one person. But the devil has one foot in the house of your heart. And you're saying, God, I want to reach people, but I know I need to be reached first. I don't know what the struggle or that vice or that habit or that you fill in the blank. Could be a relationship, could be a substance, could be a habit, could be anger, it could be a character trait. I don't know what that is. Maybe you're a leader, you're a manager, and I'm guilty of this, taking things into my own initiative when I'm not sufficient upon God to accomplish His work in His church, His work in my job. Maybe you're saying, Lord, I want to reach out to one, but first I want to be reached. And I want to surrender, just like that song we sang, I want to surrender that one thing to you today. You're saying, Lord, I want to surrender today. I don't know what that is, so that I can be someone who you can use to reach someone. If you're saying, God, I want to surrender something, you fill in that blank. Would you raise your hand with me? Hey, there's something, Lord, I want to surrender to you. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Eve is going to come up here. I do want to mention this. If you've never made a decision to be baptized, and you want to reach out to someone in 2017, but you know you need to be reached first before you can do that, and you want to make a decision to be baptized or rebaptized, you can pull out your Connect card, put your name on the front, and just mark on the back of the Connect card information on baptism. We'll contact you. We'll help you. We'll guide you along the process. We'll point you to Jesus. So mark the card. And if you're a guest here and you're visiting for the first time, we'd like to send a gift to our guests, just a token of our appreciation for visiting our church family. So fill out the put your name, put your address in city, state, zip, contact information, leave out your social security number. Put your number there, put your name. We'd like to get a gift to you if you're visiting here for the first time. My friends, we reach the world by reaching one. And God is going to use you to make an eternal impact in someone's life this year.
Hymn 573 in your hymnal. This is a, maybe some of you know it, but you'll definitely need that hymnal to let you know where the melody is. Please stand with us. It may not be on a mountain's height or over the stormy sea. It may not be at the battle's front. My Lord will have need of me. But if by a still small voice he calls to pass, I do not know. I'll answer, dear Lord, with my hand in thine. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, or mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. Perhaps today there are loving words which Jesus would have me speak. There may be now in the paths of sin whom I should seek. If thou wilt be my God, though dark and rugged the way, my voice shall echo the message sweet. I'll say what you want me to say. To go, dear Lord, or mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. There's surely somewhere a lonely place feel so wide, where I may labor through life's short day.
say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be.
Oh, Father, he first found his own brother Simon, and Philip found Nathaniel. Would you help us to reach the world by reaching one? And I thank you, Father, for Christ and what he does in and through us. And it is in his name that I pray. Amen.
Just one more word. We're glad you've joined us today. You're always welcome to join us here in worship. But we want to be available to you. If you have a prayer request, we have a prayer team that are eager to be praying for you. If you want to connect with a pastor, ask a question. If you feel you'd like to help support these teachings, being online, I want to invite you to contact the number on the screen, 970-667-7403, or the website. We'll put that on the screen for you. You go there, you can contact us, leave a prayer request, connect with us. We'd be honored to hear from you and how we can help you in your spiritual journey. But until next time, know that Jesus is searching for you.